introduction. And I would also like to thank Paul for inviting me to speak here. I'm really glad to be able to give a talk here. So the title of my talk is the Frobenius conjecture in dimension 2. It is a joint work with Sean Keel. So let me first give the plan of my talk. I will introduce the conjecture. Gross, Hacking, and Keel. Then I state the main results. In the third part, I'll tell you how to construct structure constants. Via non-Archimedean geometry. And then I will explain some theorem about finiteness. And finally, we will discuss compactification and extension of the mirror family. So let's start the first part, statement of the conjecture. So let's go to the first part. The goal of the conjecture is to have a simple conjectural construction of the mirror to an affine log Calabi-Yau variety with maximal boundary. So let me explain what is an affine log Calabi-Yau variety. So here is the context. We have Y connected smooth projective variety over complex numbers. And let D be a divisor in the anticanonical class of Y, effective XCNC divisor. We assume that D contains at least 1, 0, 1, 0 stratum. That's what this maximal boundary means. So a picture in the two-dimensional case, this is Y. And D is this SNC divisor. So let U be the interior Y minus D. And we assume U affine. And this U, we call it log Calabi-Yau variety with maximum boundary.
What do you mean by zero stratum?
Zero dimensional stratum. OK. So let us denote R be the ring generated by the monoid of curves in Y. And what we want is a mirror family curly V parametrized by spec of R. So the idea to get this mirror family is the following. We would like V to be a spec of some R algebra A. And as a module, A is free R module with basis in B of Z, where, let me explain, B is fan of YD, which means that it's the cone over the dual graph of D. So in this case, B is just this union of these cones. And BZ, they are integer points in B. So we can also think of BZ as divisorial valuations on the ring algebra, on the field of rational functions on Y. Another interpretation. So in other words, A is a free R module with basis there. So we can write A to be P inside BZ R theta P. So we can write A as a module like this. And the question is, how to obtain an R algebra structure on A. So this is what we want. We want V, the mirror V, to be spec of A. So we just write A as a R module, and we want to put an R algebra structure. And here is a gross Hacking and Kios observation. So for each n greater or equal to 2, there exists a natural multilinear map let's write it as this, from A n to R. And this map is given by counting rational curves. As follows. So we define the multilinear map. Given P1 to Pn inside BZ, and beta in the as a curve class. So we make a toric blow up let's say make a toric blow up which we denote by y tilde d tilde to yd, and this just means that blow up some strata of D such that Pi has divisorial center dPi in D tilde. So I just said that integer points there corresponds to divisorial valuations. And a priori, these divisorial valuations may not have center supported on D. So we just make some blow up. And then inside, then D tilde has more components. And the sum of D tilde corresponds to Pi. So we denote by dPi.
You mean that you want to make dPi be an irreducible divisor?
Yes, to be an irreducible component of D tilde.
Okay.
Yes. And also, from the this picture, like the fan picture, it's really clear. We just add, like when we have Pi, we just add one more ray, and we make toric blow up corresponding to adding that extra ray. Yes. So now we want to count some rational curves. And GHK's observation is that this count is really easy to define. So we define count PC, this number, to be counting things like this. We want to count, so we have y tilde, and this is d tilde, this guy. And let's assume n equals 3. So I have, let's say, here I have dp1, this divisor corresponding to p1, this divisor corresponding to p2, and let's say this divisor corresponding to p3. And we want to just count rational curves that looks like this. So more precisely, we have some marked points. Let's say this is marked point small p1, small p2, small p3, and some extra marked point r.
It's getting pretty
small. Yes. because they are small p1, p2, p3, and small r. So here I will make it bigger. We want to count a number of rational curves looks like, which looks like this. Means we consider p1 with these marked points, p1 to pn r, goes to y tilde, satisfy some condition such that first we want it intersects dp1 at the point p1 with some multiplicity. And the multiplicity is just the multiplicity of the p1. So p1 is an integer point in B. And the its multiplicity is just how many times is p1 times a primitive vector. Let me write. We want F inverse of dpi to be mi small pi, where mi is multiplicity of pi. So bigger pi equals mi times pi primitive. So when pi is primitive, this p1 is pi is primitive, we say the multiplicity is 1. Otherwise, if p1 equals 2 times the primitive vector, we require here to intersect with multiplicity 2. First condition. Second condition, we want the curve class to be beta. And then we want, so since we have many marked points in the domain, we want to fix fix the modulus of the domain. So domain, let's has fixed generic modulus. And finally, we ask f of r, this extra marked point, to be a fixed generic point in, let's say, y inside the target. OK, that's the thing we count. And
so you're allowing arbitrary intersections with the other components of the
data? Oh, that's a good question. I don't allow. They only intersect these places. Yeah, with other things, they are all zero.
So then is beta determined by the PIs?
We might still have several beta.
Why?
Oh, maybe in this case we have
a.
Yeah, in this case maybe we just have one unique beta. Oh, it just so if you just think of this combinatorics, you know, for toric variety, when we have a ray, it in the fan it gives a divisor, and this. PI, they live in the fan. So I just make a blow up so that the thing after blow up has a divisor corresponding to this ray in the direction pi. And in other words, it says that pi has divisorial center there. When we have a just two-dimensional case, we have a fan, we get a toric variety. And if we add a ray to the fan, it corresponds making some blow up. And a ray in toric in the fan corresponding to a divisor in the toric variety. So here we want that there are divisors corresponding to these directions.
So if you have like twice times the ray corresponding to a divisor, where would you blow up?
Oh, direction. It's just the direction that matters.
Direction.
Yes. Then the multiplicity mi is reflected in this condition. You don't see the multiplicity from the divisor. OK. So this thing, red curve, we can count because we have a proposition says that this set is finite and the number is well defined. So therefore, we can define our multilinear map from An to R, just given by theta p1, theta pn goes to so this is we just use counting these red things to get a multilinear map. Now we can state the conjecture. Yeah.
So when you say this number is well defined, does it mean depend on the choice of blow up?
Or? Yeah, it doesn't depend on choice of blow up, this modulus, fixed point, and so on. Yes. So conjecture of Gross, Hacking, and Keel is first the pairing. If I set n equals 2, the pairing is non-degenerate. Or maybe we can say the pairing is non-degenerate. It's the same. Then there exists a commutative R algebra structure on A such that first the unit of A is given by the base theta 0. And the second, we want trace of the product A1 until An is just given by the pairing A1 to An. And third, just when we make multiplication, we want the coefficient before the unit. Yes. So finally, spec A to spec R, restricted to the torus inside our base. To the torus inside our base is a family of affine log Calabi-Yau varieties of same dimension with maximal boundary. So this is a the beautiful conjecture of Gross, Hacking, and Keel. You see that it conjectures what the mirror shall be, and the information involved in the conjecture are really simple counts of rational curves.
So, R captures all of the non-effective classes on Y.
Yeah.
But some because of your conditions, you only, the actual non-trivial dependence is only on the part that's orthogonal to the components of D, right? You can't really deform the direction of the components of D.
Yeah, some part is just the same. Yes. So the main results that I will explain in my talk is that the conjecture holds in dimension 2. So let me explain you the idea. How do we get this algebra structure? So the idea is to construct the structure constants of A by counting holomorphic disks. So it's similar to this. Let me explain what to count. For P1 to Pn in BZ, we define structure constants, which is we take a product theta P1 to theta Pn, write it as Q in BZ, sum of gamma in Ne of Y, and mu P1 Pn Q gamma Z gamma theta Q. So let me denote this by star. This equality is nothing. It just express the multiplication rule by the sum. And now we want to define this. This is our structure constants. So we count our structure constants. We define our structure constants by counting holomorphic disks. So let tau U to B be an SYZ vibration. And mu, this structure constant, P1, Pn, Q, gamma, counts holomorphic disks as follows. So we again have this picture. Let's consider the case n equals 2. So we have the picture like this. This is our y tilde. And we have, let's say, this divisor corresponds to P1, and this divisor corresponds to P2. We want to count holomorphic disks, which looks like this. So in order to be rigorous, we also need to fix some marked points, P1, a small P1, P2, and R. So we want holomorphic disks, which is just a picture for the case n equals 2. Yes, but the words is general. So we consider holomorphic disks, a disk with marked points P1 to Pn R goes to Y tilde, such that the following condition. First, we want R is in the boundary, and all the other things, they are in the interior. And then we ask the same condition as we ask also this intersection numbers with the boundaries. And for that special marked point, we put the condition that tau of f, oh, boundary condition, of the boundary of disk, we want it to be in a fixed point B, in big B, near the ray OQ. So just means that the boundary of the disk lies on the porous fiber over a point B, which is near the ray OQ. And some other benign condition. We want a curve class gamma. So I'll just write, it's not very precise. We want the class of the sphere to be gamma, and the class of the boundary to be Q. And moreover, we put these generic conditions, same generic conditions as before. So we have generic domain, and FR is in a generic, a fixed generic point. Inside the fiber torus. So if you are confused by the list of conditions, just think we count these kind of disks.
So if you didn't fix the domain, then there would be a regularity issue, and you might have to count stable disks with components of T inside them. But for a generic domain, that does not come up.
Yes. Yes. So this tau f, this boundary of disk, just means boundary of disk is in a torus fiber. Uh-huh. Yes.
So Q is moving here?
No, here let's fix this. I'm defining mu of p1, pn, q, gamma. So p1 to pn, q, gamma, they are all fixed. Yes. So there are some, maybe, let's say, it's a bit more difficult to count these disks than rational curves. For example, a priori, the set depends a priori on many choices. So for example, we have tau, there's a choice, and also choice of B, choice of generic point, generic domain. In my work with Sean Keel, our way to make this precise is to the strategy to overcome these choices and make it precise is we use the theory of non-Archimedean enumerative geometry that I developed in my thesis. So now I will explain how to use the non-Archimedean enumerative geometry in my thesis to make this easier to work with. So the first step that we do is to replace the SYZ vibration tau U to B by a so-called non-Archimedean analytic SYZ vibration.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
So what's the meaning of this summation star here? Q could be infinite, right?
Yes, that will be my first part of the talk, which will say that actually the two sums are finite sums. We have finiteness theorems. A priori, they are infinite sums. Yes. So we want to make this heuristic picture precise using some non-Archimedean geometry. First is that in non-Archimedean geometry, this SYZ vibration, there is a unique best SYZ vibration. And the construction is very easy. So this non-Archimedean SYZ vibration is canonical and explicit. Here is the construction. We take K to be the field of Laurent power series, non-Archimedean field. Oh, if you are not familiar with non-Archimedean geometry, maybe you just take a break and and you go back from step two, maybe. So we take non-Archimedean field. You only need to remember that we have a non-Archimedean analytic SYZ vibration that is canonical and explicit. Now I will explain how to construct it. Yes. Oh, because boundary is a circle.
Yeah.
And if you look at homology of the fiber, which is a torus, you can think Q as an element in the homology, like H1 of the torus.
The cycle which generates is equal to Q.
You ask this, the class of the S1 is Q. Yeah, so let's do some. This K, Laurent power series field, we make a base change U to K, and we see that this analytic, this is a variety over K, and we can consider the analytification. It's a non-Archimedean analytic space over K. So, let me say that how to get this non-Archimedean SYZ vibration. For component di of d, we know that di is a divisor. So locally, di is defined by a function ui. And we can take a valuation of ui, so over our non-Archimedean space, and this gives a continuous function on our analytic space. So the non-Archimedean SYZ vibration tau from UK analytic to B is just x goes to valuation of ui of x. Yes, and this non-Archimedean SYZ vibration is canonical. So just now we were worrying dependence on the choice of SYZ vibration. And in this world, we get an explicit canonical SYZ vibration. So, OK. So now, step two. So for people who took a break, you can come back to step two. Now, no more knowledge about non-Archimedean geometry is needed. Denis is back. So now we want to count holomorphic disks in YK analytic. just similar conditions, but let me restate. Such that we ask P1 to Pn in the interior of our disk, and same condition of intersection with the boundary. Same conditions, and again, same conditions. We ask the boundary to live in the torus fiber. Near the ray OQ. I'm just repeating myself there. And we want the class to be gamma. And that condition is we can reformulate as tau f of a neighborhood of the boundary to be equal to direction q. This is our base point B. And finally, we fix generic domain and this same thing. Generic domain plus FR is a fixed generic point. Yes. So almost the same conditions, but in the non-Archimedean setting. So we want to count this set. And the trouble is that still, with these conditions, this set is infinite. And we don't get a well-defined number, because we can still vary many, many parameters keeping these conditions. So the solution of this trouble from my thesis is the following. We just impose an extra so-called regularity condition on the boundary. What do we mean by this? We have our disk like this. And since we are in analytic geometry, we can do analytic continuation at the boundary. And we ask, by analytic continuation at the boundary, our disk extends straight to, like our disk extends all straight, let's say. And what do I mean by all straight? It means that its image in B is straight with respect to the integral affine structure on B. So picture is that we require that when we do analytic continuation, it extends like this. And the part of the yellow tail, when we project to B, it's straight with respect to the integral affine structure. Sorry? Yeah, it's a tail, yellow. And it's we require its image in B is straight with respect to the integral affine structure. So the good news is that with this extra condition, the space of holomorphic disks in YK analytic satisfying this extra condition. So first satisfying all these conditions, satisfying all these conditions plus boundary regularity condition is a finite set. And it's good to have a finite set because we can count how many points are there in the finite set. So remark, for those who came to my mini course last month, or for those who have watched the videos, this subset actually decomposes. This finite set decomposes into subsets according to the spine associated to these disks. And now, let me say that we have another trouble, bigger trouble. Trouble two is that this boundary regularity condition still depend on some choices. So the reason is that.
Can I ask you? I'm not confused. With this lifting things up onto the non-Archimedean space, did you actually solve the problem of dependence of your construction on choices?
I'm explaining now. I just solved some dependence. Now I'm solving some other dependence.
Which dependence did you solve?
For example, dependence of the SYZ vibration.
Okay.
Now we are solving another. Trouble of dependence. So the thing is that when we have this thing, this disk, we asked that the boundary goes to a fixed point B near the ray. So we have the ray like this. OQ. And we want this is close. This boundary is close to the ray OQ. And when we ask that it extends straight with respect to the integral affine structure on B, that depends on whether this boundary is on the left or on the right of this ray. So for example, if it's on the left, it may extend. Being straight may be like this. This may be straight in the integral affine structure. But if it is on the right, then being straight may have a different meaning, like this. So we have two different regularity conditions on the boundary. Right. Extending straight on the left side of OQ differs from extending straight on the right side of OQ. So it means that our counts still depends on some choice. So the solution is we define yet one more regularity condition on the boundary. So we define another regularity condition by saying that we want our by analytic continuation, we want our holomorphic disk extend straight with respect to a toric model, which means it's a blowdown of Y to a toric variety. This guy is toric. So then a theorem is that counts using the left, like regularity condition on the left, equals counts using the toric regularity condition, and equals counts using the right regularity condition. So corollary is that our counts are well defined.
Just a quick question.
Yes.
So can you just explain why you expected to get a finite number after imposing this the first regularity condition?
Oh, it's why do we get a finite number? It follows from properness and also smoothness of the. One can prove both properness and smoothness of the moduli space. So corollary, the counts mu p1, pn, q, gamma, they are well defined. And so now this formula has more sense. And the theorem associativity says that if we define multiplication using this formula, theta p1, theta pn, if we define multiplication, and if we add arbitrary parentheses in between, so just add arbitrary parentheses, then this equals the multiplication without adding parentheses. So yes, we are finished section the part three. And now let's consider some finiteness theorems. So natural question is whether the sums in our formula star are finite. So are the sigmas in star finite? And it's an important question, because if they are not finite, then we only get a formal algebra instead of genuine algebra. But we want a genuine algebra. So theorem.
I'm sorry. Before explaining this finite, what's the meaning of this summation? So what do you do? Your Q is the. What does Q represent in this SYG vibration?
Because a Q has the same role as P1 to Pn. Because the basis of our algebra as a module, they are parametrized by points in BZ. Therefore, yes. Therefore, when I take a product, I want to express it as sum over basis. So this theta q is basis for our algebra. That's what the structure constants means. In an algebra, when we take two bases of, let's say we have a vector space has some basis. And if we want to put an algebra structure, it means that I take two bases of the vector space.
The problem, what I confuse you, there is you're counting some disk.
Yeah.
And the boundary lies in something over Q. Okay.
Oh, this you the real Q appears here. I want the homology class of the boundary to be Q.
What do you mean by homology class of boundary?
Because boundary is S1. So S1 has a homology class in the fiber. fiber is a torus, and the Q represents some.
Fiber over what?
Fiber over the SYZ vibration.
So Q
represents. So if I may, so the Otman's pattern looks like a C star to the N locally, not quite, but piecewise. And in that C star to the N, the first homology of your torus, Tn, product torus, is identified with the integer points of the topologization, which you can think of as directions at infinity for compactifying. Directions of compactification for the N are the same as homology passes of the torus.
Yes. So,
can I also ask, because in the former cases, aren't these sums finite?
I'm explaining finite.
I mean, in this count as well. Like, for finiteness, you don't have to go to non-Archimedean setup. Right? Already.
But I said that the difficulty is about dependence on various choices, not for finiteness. Yes. So, yeah, I'm sorry I didn't have time to explain the more ideas about finiteness, but let me just state the theorems. Finiteness 1 says that given p1 to pn in BZ, there exists finitely many, at most, finitely many pair Q gamma such that mu P1 Pn Q gamma is non-zero. So this says that our sum is finite. And corollary is that A is now an associative commutative R algebra. And we have another finiteness theorem, which says that A is a finitely generated R algebra. So in the remaining minutes, let me explain that this our mirror can be made compact and also over some bigger base. So section 5, we have constructed spec A over spec R. This is our mirror. And in order to obtain more information about this mirror, now we don't know much. We only know that it makes sense to take spec A. And it's kind of a family of variety. But in order to know more about this family, we need to compactify the fibers of this family and as well as to extend it over a bigger base. So, in order to compactify, we fix F ample divisor on Y such that support of F equals D. And this gives us a filtration on A, on the algebra A, given by A less than equal to S, is just generated by the basis theta q for q. So q is in BZ. And we want f trop of q is bounded by s. So f ample divisor, and we can define its tropical function, which is a real valued function on B. And we define a filtration A less than equal to s is just generated by basis whose corresponding q has whose f trop is less than equal to s. And once we have filtration, we get a subalgebra, A tilde inside A with one more variable T generated by ATS, where A in A. So it's just considered the subalgebra. And now the compactification is take a proj of this algebra, A tilde, and it's over spec R. So this is fiber-wise compactification of spec A over spec R. So now, just by doing this simple procedure, we get compactified mirrors. But we also want to make our base bigger. So now our base is spec of R. And let me recall you that R is NE, is the ring generated by the monoid of curves in Y. And we know that NE of Y, the cone of curves, is due to the nth cone of Y. So the nth cone lives in divisors, the numerical equivalence classes of divisors on Y. So in other words, we can rewrite spec R as the toric variety associated to the nth cone of Y. So before I just write spec R, but by this observation, spec R is toric variety associated to the nth cone of Y. So now we extend our family to a larger base. And the larger base is the toric variety associated to the Mori fan of Y, which contains this toric variety. It's a partial compactification of this toric variety. So maybe I don't have time to define what Mori fan is. Maybe I define by words. So this, we have a nth cone lying in this R vector space. And the Mori fan is a fan, again, in this vector space. But it has more cones than this nth cone. And the cones of Mori fan, they correspond to some explanation. The cones of Mori fan, they correspond to things like, which corresponds to things like pi y to y prime birational map with y prime normal. And for each such birational map, we can get a cone in N1, which just consists of divisors that are linear combination of pullback of divisors in nth divisors in Y prime plus the exceptional divisors of this map. So theorem is that our compactified family X over R spec R extends over this bigger base, toric variety of the Mori fan of Y. And moreover, we have a good knowledge for what's the restriction of this family over various strata of this toric variety. For example, the strata corresponding to this birational map, the restriction of the family over such strata will just be the whole construction running again for the pair y prime d prime. So we can find other things in this bigger family. So I have no time. And a final theorem of my talk is that by this compactification plus extension, we can get many properties for our family X over this bigger base. And for example, this family has nice properties. Maybe I just write like this. And I explain by word that first is that this family, they have some kind of smoothness. So and moreover, when we restrict this family to the when we restrict this family to the open torus on the base, we have an even better smoothness. And that better smoothness mainly says that the restriction to the open base is, again, a log Calabi-Yau surface with maximum boundary and with, at worst, canonical singularities. Thank you very much for your attention.